Hello my friends and welcome back to another episode of Flutter Explained. Today we have again an interview and a coding session with a very good friend of mine, Dmytro Gladkyi. He has more than 14 years of software engineering and knowledge and also 2 years in Flutter projects. And he created two very cool projects that he is sharing today with us. The first one is an interactive fiction engine and the second one is a city builder game. And he wants to talk a little bit more about both of these interesting topics and also some animation he will share with us. And now, without further ado, let's get started. All right. So, hey, Dmytro. Hi, nice to see you here around. So, can you tell me something about yourself?
Yeah, hi, Max. Thank you for inviting me for the interview. So, I'm a software developer. So, I do Flutter for my hobby project. So at my day job, I am a web developer. I'm working for SAP company. Mm-hmm. And so I selected, like, I think I started doing Flutter like 7 years ago. Mm-hmm. And just, you know, in getting an introduction to it, because I started doing web development. I did not like JavaScript. I saw Dart. You know, even at that time, there was a Dartium browser when mm-hmm. they had it built in. And so I used it, I pretty liked it. And maybe 2 or 3 years ago, I saw that Dart did not die. So mm-hmm. there was this Flutter framework. And what I liked is that you can really easily create interfaces without all of that CSS magic, mm-hmm. arcane magic. And I liked it. And after several investigations, I decided to do all my hobby projects, all my side projects using Flutter. Mm-hmm. And I am doing this for 2 years. And so I released one game, interactive fiction story game. It's available for all platforms, web, iOS, Android. And currently I'm creating a city building game. So it's still in progress. Today I will show it to you. Mm-hmm. Maybe we can even check how I did this interactive fiction. Mm-hmm. Because there are today, I tried to not to remember the code. I did not see it, maybe from autumn.
All right.
So I spawned a couple bugs. So maybe we will do this. I saw that something is wrong with state management. This is a very hot topic, mm-hmm. and so I think maybe we could see what we can do with this bug. I did not fix them yet, but
okay,
that we can do it.
Sounds great. Absolutely, that would be fantastic. So I will add these two links down in the video description so that we have them also in place in the video description so people can just have a look there. Mm-hmm. Great. Cool. So can you tell me something about your projects? I seen already you have prepared a lot, so I'm really interested. What are you doing at the moment as side projects with Flutter? Because
so my first project is an interactive story fiction. It's a game, an application. So interactive means that you are reading a story, and I can actually even show it. So I have created. They are written in Ukrainian language. It's about our history. Mm-hmm. And when you read the story, you can proceed to different passages. You see there are different images. Mm-hmm. And here are two options. So you decide how the story will develop.
Okay.
So for example, I can select this. This way, and you see the story continues. Mm-hmm. And you can go on. So at first I used third-party interactive story engine. Mm-hmm. They were used to create this story and to actually have a runtime. Yeah, so when they're running on Android or web. But what I did not like about them is that they have a very specific domain, specific language. Yeah, it's a very mm-hmm. custom language. Something like a mix of Perl and Markdown, so it looks terrible. Then you have to write it in this format, then compile it to some other format in order to run it. Mm-hmm. So I decided to abandon that engine, and instead I created my own. So okay. I thought it's good to create. So here is the GitHub page. So I call it Glad Stories Engine. It's pretty simple, actually, just a JSON format. So I have a JSON schema for it. It's mm-hmm. it's a JSON, so we can even check it. So why did I do it this way? It's because I, at the beginning I was always like switching framework, and mm-hmm. I wanted to keep the core as small as possible. So that's why I use JSON. And then I switch between, you know, ReasonML, I've tried Angular, React, ReasonML with React, and so on. Mm-hmm. I tried Svelte, I think, framework as well. And at the end, yeah, I decided to stick with Flutter. It was at the moment when, remember, on the conference, first Flutter conference, they announced one more thing, that Flutter now compiles to web. Mm-hmm. I was so shocked because I wanted to target only native, like Android and iOS. Yes. And when I heard that, I decided, yeah, that's that point when I will not return back to real web development. I will do this web. Mm-hmm. And so that's JSON format is good because you can use any editor to edit it. Later, you can import it. And in this way, I am not stuck to my application, yeah, because my application can also be used to create interactive fiction. So they use absolutely the same format. So you can create it, you can run it, you can share it with your friends, so they can import it, and so on. And so while I was doing this, let me continue with my package. So I implemented, like API wrappers around it in Dart. So there is Dart package. I published it, I actually used it. Mm-hmm. It has a green state, 50 per percent score. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there are some outdated Eric's Dart, I think. Yeah. And another part is implemented in Smalltalk. So I used I did it actually to investigate this Faro environment, Smalltalk. I really like this liveliness of Flutter and Faro. Mm-hmm. So that's why I did it as well there. And I used it. It's again, pretty simple. It exposes API, so there are a lot of examples. So actually, you can create your story by using this example and even proceed it. So it can be, it is written in pure Dart, so there is no Flutter involved in it, so it's just Dart. And this allowed me to completely remove this custom iOS build, because previous engines that I used, they had open source, bindings. For the Android, for the Java, not for Android, but for Java. I even had to modify it in order to compile for Android and for iOS. And for iOS was actually Objective-C code, but it called JavaScript, JavaScript or something like that. So it was wrapper around wrapper, and I really did not like it. With each macOS and Xcode update, I had to investigate why my build is now failing. So what are these new build settings for Xcode and so on. So now everything is in Dart, it runs in web, so everything is supported, you see. Flutter, Android, iOS, web, native, JS, so everything is supported.
Great.
Yeah, and so I also use, by the way, I really like this widget. So you see you have a story and you would like to export it to, for example, to PDF, to share with somebody. So it will be like a book, without the options for you, but this is how you pass this story. So what you can do is it's exporting. And by the way, there is a, you see, I'm exporting images. Mm-hmm. This is done because we can even, I think, jump into the code for this. Yeah, so the PDF was ready. Because I spent, I think, 2 weeks doing this. It was pretty tricky to do, so. Mm-hmm. So share story, yeah. So what? I never remember the structure of my widget. So I remember I heard somewhere on the conference from Flutter team. They say do not care about the structure of your widgets, how deep they are. So Flutter engine will do. So it will flatten. It will use render objects. I don't know what it means, but so they say it will be fast. I believe them. It's really fast if you do everything correctly. Yeah. If you don't do some heavy things inside your main thread. And so I usually just pick a button, and then see what is happening. So inside my code, I hope it's visible. I can increase the font. Mm-hmm. So on YouTube, and what is going on? So let me pdf.save. Ah, here. So there is a package, really great package. And what I like about the Flutter is that everything is a widget, and you can compose everything. And the same absolutely aspects for this package PDF. So it's called PDF. Mm-hmm. And you can actually create PDF by using widget. So let me find an example. There should be some an example page. So actually what you do, you construct a PDF document, add the page, and everything in this build method. So these are just widgets. Yeah, you see center, this is not Flutter center widget, but this is a widget from the PDF package. Mm-hmm. So everything is the same, like container, box decorations, images, text, alignment, and so on. Everything like was done, but it compiles not to the screen,
wow.
Not to the screen, but to PDF. Yeah, really great. I was so surprised when I saw it, and I can even check, see how I do it. You see there is container, box decoration.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a page, A4 format, yeah, standard format. And these are not Flutter containers, yeah, Flutter widgets. These are all from PDF, coming from PDF. There are a little bit of differences between the real Flutter widget and PDF widget. But actually, see, text style is also, so you can do whatever you want. And
nice.
You just construct it. Yeah, but I had this, I had the problem with images, because images must be sent to the PDF document as a list of unsigned integers, mm-hmm. I think. And for that to do, they must be loaded into the memory. So, and mm-hmm. this is a synchronous process. So that's why you can't just say, like, PDF, here are five references to the files, yeah, on the hard drive of the device, and construct me PDF. No, this is, constructing of PDF is a synchronous process, but loading images is not. So I had to do this screen, yeah, when mm-hmm. When I press start. So this is actually reading the images and exporting them to these unsigned integers, yeah, so to
yes.
the raw data, I think I mm-hmm. was called correctly. And so that was, I think, my first, you know, let me find it. By the way, you can even load four custom fonts for the PDF. I was very surprised when I saw it. And let me quickly find, here, load images. Mm-hmm. And these images are the same as you see in this story. So mm-hmm. this is the forest with the field, a river, and so on. So they must be also in this document. And at first I implemented it very naively. So it was like more than 1 year ago. I just did a for each, a sync load. Mm-hmm. And actually, this function, it never waited on all of the files to be loaded. And I was surprised, like, what's going on? I have a for each. Inside for each, I have a sync. It mm-hmm. should wait. And actually, you can't do this. You have to use, there is future. Yeah. So, there
mm-hmm.
is, yeah. So future has an interface for each.
Mm-hmm.
And it waits on this function to finish. And actually, I just collect the, you see, future's completed. So I just, you know, collect them once they are done. And once this method returns, mm-hmm. all of the images are already converted to the integers, so to some digits.
So that's fantastic. Like, I didn't know that the future has an interface for each. That is great.
Yeah, at first I think I had something like this. So it was very naive implementation. For var, for example, mm-hmm. image items. Yeah, and here I had this async, like var image, await, yeah, so await load or something like this, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And it did not work as I expected.
Mm-hmm.
And I think after doing the Stack Overflow and Dart Doc, I found this method. Maybe there is another way of doing it, but this works. So it loads from the hard drive, then it does this compute method. Yeah, by the mm-hmm. way, you see, I use compute in order, I think, to unload the heavy weight stuff from the main thread.
Mm-hmm.
And I was surprised that this side project, last time I checked, I had 1,300 registered users.
Wow, congratulations.
So, yeah, I stopped tracking these users because I removed all of the I use Firebase
mm-hmm.
as a document storage and Firebase authentication. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
but then Apple introduced this Apple Sign In, and they said that it's not possible to use Google authentication without providing Apple authentication.
Yes.
And I thought, like, why do I need them? I wanted just to track users, that some users read this story and so on.
Mm-hmm.
And I just decided that I don't need it. I saw that, like, a lot of people from Ukraine started reading it. I even got emails from kids, I think, from teenagers saying that, thank you for this. I like your story. But there are only 4 stories, so why don't you create more stories? I said, I don't have time. It takes about 3 weeks to create 1 story. Yeah, so I remove everything from it. And yeah, by the way, I have a separate article. You see this animation.
Mm-hmm.
I call it revolver animation. So I did it because I wanted not just like simple scroll, yeah, so we could list you, but I use this is page view with this vertical scroll. Mm-hmm. And I do, you see, different transitions. It was really interesting for me to do. So you see the first item, and I can see the title of the next book. You see, it's a little
bit. Yes.
Showing. But when I start dragging it, at some mm-hmm. moment, you will see that, you see that the mm-hmm. top item, now title is at the bottom. Yeah, you see, and it starts fading away. So it's fading out. I think I changed the opacity. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I reduce opacity, and now we have this. And it works pretty well, and I think I even have an article mm-hmm. on my blog, and there is a Dartpad example with the same.
Very
and
nice.
These are images, and they're pretty huge, and they work in the web. Yeah, that's pretty good.
Cool.
Yeah, that was, I think, the hardest part that I did with animation, because I am more like, right now I try to add more features to my game before mm-hmm. I start beautifying it with all of these images and transitions and so on. So I really like this. I spent mm-hmm. maybe 5 days, but they're like full days doing this transition. And also I have a editor for the interactive fiction.
Oh, very nice.
Yeah, and by the way, all of these four stories, they were created by using this editor.
Oh.
So my son goes to sport club, so
mm-hmm.
and while I wait on him to finish, I have 1 or 2 hours of free time. And what I did, I just had my Galaxy Note or iPhone,
okay.
and I use this editor. So, for example, we can create a new story. And in this editor, I recently refactored it because mm-hmm. I removed Firebase support. And I think I introduced a couple of bugs. So maybe we will catch them today.
Mm-hmm.
So you just, this is a simple form, by the way. This was pain in the ass to implement this text forms. I really, like, so much code had to be implemented.
Mm-hmm.
You know that on save, there are callbacks for all of each field.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to catch them in the text edited form or something like this. So,
mm-hmm.
but you can, for example, edit it. And here is a simple interface. So you add a passage. Yeah, so you can type, for example, test one. You can even attach, say that for this passage, you will, the application must show, for example, both. Yeah, so this mm-hmm. image with. And for this one, let me say that it should be set. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And so let me have some tests. Test 2. And here we have, so after reader passes test 2, so the second passage, I mm-hmm. want him to actually decide how the story will continue. So I will have this editing. So I will have question 1, question 2. Yeah, this part of my application is really bad here. But I do this only like once or twice. So question 1, question 2. And what's good about JSON, so this structure, is that it's a recursive data structure.
Mm-hmm.
So each page, it can have a question. Yeah, so this is page, set of nodes. And after each question, you just go to that another specific page. And mm-hmm. it has absolutely the same structure. It can also have different nodes, another question. So that questions lead to another part of the story. So that's recursive tree structure, and was pretty fun to implement. So let me just, you see, I press on question 1, and this is what the user will see when he uses it.
Mm-hmm.
She, I tell that the main hero will leave after this passage is completed, and the question two, so let him die. Yeah. It will be a very short story. Only one question. And by the way, I checked the Firebase database. So users of this application really used it. They created very, very short stories. It was very fun to read for me. I copied them and I checked. So a lot of them are kids. So a lot of them were kids because you can see that kid story. Very simple. And so, and now what you can do, you can press read. Yeah, and you see that I have this red screen of death. Yeah, so let's check what's going on. So I press on this. Yeah, it's visible. Should I increase the font or it's okay?
That's all right, I think. I think that's good to read.
So, and it says that you see the valid range is empty. It says, so the image path is empty. I check from if it is null. But it seems that the list is there, so it is not null. So this is list, I think, image path. Yeah, list of strings. But it is empty, and it expected it to be at least one element should be there. Let me quickly show how I can debug it. And so maybe we can even touch the state changes. Yeah, so image path, let's see. So it goes to my Glad Stories engine. You see, this is the yellow file because, yeah, it came to my package. And so image path, and it's empty. And let's see who or what initializes it. Yeah, so let me find. So I think log current passage. So when the user presses a button, what I do, I take the text, take the image, and add it to the history. So that's like a history of the story. And you see that it seems that it cannot do it. Image resolver. It cannot. It did not add anything to the image passes because this if did not work out. So let me. So we have an empty array, but it did not add anything to it. So we can quickly check what is image resolver and why it is null. How it can be null? So image resolver. I think it should be somewhere in constructor. Yeah, so here it is. So we think that the consumer of this story package did not provide the value for its image resolver. And image resolver, so I tried to make my library a little bit abstract, so you can add JSON to it, but my library doesn't know where to search for the images. And that's why you must provide it an image resolver, and my library will call an image resolver, like say, I have this passage with type, for example, bold, give me image for it. So it's the responsibility of the consumer of this page to get it. And so let me then find who creates this story in my code. So I think we should find it. Let me do this quickly. Story. Yeah, unfortunately, new story. No one calls it like that anymore. I remember when I started, I dust, everyone was still writing this new object to instantiate an object. Everyone was calling this new constructor, but now it just not calling. So let me.
I think Edgar removed some in some version of Dart, right? So and since then, everyone starts to remove it.
Yeah. So we can quickly trace down. So history item again. That's not it. Passage item use, so who creates it, and we can, you know, figure out who sent this history item. So there is an array of history items, and what I do, I create for each of them a separate widget. Yeah, so history. History is an input parameter. Again, history, snapshot data. And I have a stream builder. Yeah, history changes, current story. Okay. Oh, that's long path. So, the girl story view. Game view. So someone said the story. So game view. Game view is what is executed when you press read. So it's a game view. It's a runtime view. Yes, you see it's a final story. So someone really sent it without the So let's try to find who calls it game view. Game view. wrong link. Here I'm using the routine. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I passed the. I decided to use this technique from the Flutter cookbook, where you create a separate class. It accepts some arguments, and, mm-hmm. and only then you call the real widget, which should be responsible for that page, yeah, of your application. So I have this name everywhere. And edit story. Come on, we are almost there. No? Did I return to the same? The story detail view. Story. Almost there. Ooh. And I'm not sure, by the way, what would happen if I use, for example, inherited widget, mm-hmm. you know, to provide the story for all of the children. Yeah, would it be easier? I'm not sure. I'm using inherited widget for some occasions in my new game. Yeah, but what will be here? So return story view. Then where is it? Let me return back. So here is story. User details. Finally. This is who constructs the story. You see, mm-hmm. the story doesn't exist, so that's why when you press create new story, it's an empty, so a metadata is empty. And you see that if you press story image resolver, in Dart, you cannot specify it as a required field. So you cannot add required. I was really missing this, and that's why you see it cost a buck already for me, because the consumer of the story, it did not provide any image resolver. I think it's background image. Let me import it. Not it. Let's see who already did it. I can copy paste my own code. mm-hmm. Like this. And import it. No background image. Let me quickly search for it. Background, here it is. So did it compile? Background image, yes, so here it is. And by the way, this is a good use case for the assertion. So you see, this is a constructor. Mm-hmm. Actually here I could add this assert, you know, statement, like when they check if the input is what you expect. When you cannot type check it, or like I have here, you see, image resolver, I cannot specify it shouldn't be null. Mm-hmm. But I don't remember, it's actually, I don't like the syntax. It's very hard to read. Every hard to write, so it's easy to read, but hard to write. Mm-hmm. But actually, I could add it like, assert image resolver is not null. And actually, it would raise me exception, not instead of the runtime when it actually does. You see how many widgets we click. But actually, it would raise me directly here, so at the very mm-hmm. beginning of the problem. So that's a good use case for the assertions, and I will actually use them because I never use them. I saw a lot of Flutter widgets use them, so that's mm-hmm. I think good to have. And I think that the story is already there, so I need to create another story, because this story is already corrupted. So Flutter is live environment, but there are some limits. Mm-hmm. So let me switch back. So create new story. Title 1, 2, 3. Edit. So let's see. I will add some dummy data. Belarus. Mm-hmm. Yeah, now you see it works. That's a river. So you see a good use case that as required is not mm-hmm. provided by Dart, because my package is only Dart without Flutter. I did not want to add Flutter to it. And using assertions actually is a good way to reduce amount of such errors. It's a primitive error. I did not provide the mm-hmm. constructor argument. And that's one of them. And I think I saw another issue with my code here. So I think if I remove this if I remove this, let me save it. Yes, so and return. So it's here, but if I remove it, you see it's not removed from the list.
Okay.
I saw this issue, and actually, that's a problem related to the state management. Because what is going on? So if I go to the screen, remove it. So actually, what I do, I usually start investigating this by using this Flutter inspector because I don't remember the structure of my widget. So I have this remove button. What it does, you see, it deletes the story and then pops the context, the navigator. And it pops it. So let's see who uses this widget. List view, I think, yeah, user. Let me close unnecessary steps. Yeah. If I'm too fast, you can tell me.
No, that's all right.
That's normal path. Okay. So I modify the storage, but I think that the widget that renders the list of the available stories, it doesn't reread them. Yeah. So that's why on the hard drive they do not exist, but in memory they are still there. And widget doesn't know when to refresh to. So let me check who, I think, yeah. So there is a method that builds a list of, yeah, so here it is. So story persistence, I think this is my wrapper around the persistence layer. So it knows how to save. So it's like a handmade database. It knows where to store the stories, where are the built-in stories. So let me. Let me check what to do here. And it, what it does, it deletes creator story. Yes. So let me check if it really deletes them. Yes. So this is called. So I remove them by title. You can have only one book with the same title. So you see the previous item was gone, but this is still here. Yes. So and what I like about Flutter, you can retrigger the set state by pressing this select widget mode. What it will do, it will rebuild the widget tree. That is visible. So yeah, instead of hot reloading or doing something else. So let me go here again. So let me just create a dummy, absolutely empty screen. Save. So now I should, yes, I see it. And now if I remove, I don't see it. I think no one will call this. Yeah, so I remove it. Yeah, you see, this method to rebuild this widget was not called. So this is absolutely a state management problem. And what is even worse that I think when I press on this button, so let me check. Oops, it's gone because I should take the state change. Okay, let me save it just a dummy. So if I so let's see who calls it. Yeah, you see that actually I could, you know, parse the callbacks that this is the callback when the story is removed. So I can provide it to this widget, create story. Let's see who creates them. Yeah, this is story view. So what I could do, like on story delete, yeah, and parse something like set state, for example, yeah. I don't care what was removed, just I know that the state must be refreshed. Yeah. But then I need to, you know, like a needle, I need to dig it deeper. And there might be, as we saw already, five different widgets. And so not all of them need this callback. They are like a proxy between widgets. And what's good about Flutter is like composability. And when I was thinking how to fix this, what I found is that this story persistence, so it exposes a singleton instance because there is only one hard drive. Yeah, so, and all of these methods, they work against it. So, and I was thinking like how to notify all widgets that content of the stories or amount of stories changed. And for this, I usually do even, I think I started doing this in Objective-C like 10 years ago. I created another turn-based game, and I always use this Redux style approach. So I have behavior subject, how it's written correctly. Behavior subject, can it import it? Yeah. It stopped working. Let me refresh it. So I always like this Rx Dart package. Mm-hmm. I use it also in JavaScript on my previous job. We use it a lot for the WebSocket communications and so on. And it has this behavior. I don't know why, but it stopped working the after completion. Maybe I have some syntax errors. So let me check. No, they are not. Behavior subject. Let me check how it's written. Ah, yes. Like this.
Perfect.
So changes. So mm-hmm. what I usually do for like my own approach for state management, it's a, like, I think, Redux approach. That's why I like Redux when I saw it in Dan Abramov's work, at the very beginning of the React. So what I do, so this story persistence, it will expose the behavior subject, mm-hmm. and it contains the stream. And each time I know that, for example, I remove the story, I'll delete the story. What I can do is changes, add, and for example, mm-hmm. this will, I will publish myself, inside this stream. And so now I need to do this only when this thing, and this is future, so I will select var result, await. After that, I do notify whoever listens to it, and mm-hmm. return result. So at first I remove, I wait on the removal mm-hmm. because it modifies the application preferences, and then I return the result. It's still bool, so boolean, so everything should work. So now we have a stream and we can notify users. For example, when someone creates a new story, we can also add the thing like trigger point. And now this screen, so instead of, let me show you that this is it. So this story list view, so it's huge. So story list view. That's a scaffold with a column. So all of these buttons living inside column. So I will mm-hmm. just wrap it with a stream builder. That's stream builder. So we are not lucky. It doesn't mm-hmm. want to help me to write it. And I have, I think it's like story persistence. instance.changes.stream,
mm-hmm.
And usually I hide these changes. I only expose stream because I don't want some alien widget, sending some data into my stream. That's, I think, a bad idea. Mm-hmm. I want it to be encapsulated. Only story persistence can tell when something changed, not when something. It will be, like jQuery style of programming that everybody can do everything. So it's pretty bad. And we need this builder. I think it's like this context data, snapshot data.
And child.
Snapshot data. Is this correct? And I will just return this return mm-hmm. column. I don't care what data came in.
Mm-hmm.
I will just rebuild by, it's a singleton. It will always contain the latest changes. So I can simplify here. So. And now comes this game, find the correct the correct matching bracket. Curly bracket. Reload it. So now let's go, remove. Oh, you see, it's gone.
Perfect.
Let me check here. And let's check if it really called, if mm-hmm. it's really building from here. So save, edit. Yes, we can read it. I'm just checking.
Mm-hmm.
Back and remove. Let's see that it's really there. Oh, you see that?
Mm-hmm.
Rebuild, wants to rebuild. Title, removing title. You see Stream Builder catches that notification from the story persistence. Something changed. You see it's now removed.
Very good.
And actually I was surprised that I used this, again, in Objective-C, I had this set of actions which you can issue. So in this case, story persistence is like a action store and the storage. It contains the data for the widget, mm-hmm. and at the same time it contains what can be done against this data. So like you can get stories, you can write, remove, modify, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
And after that I started using this approach, and actually for me, maybe because this is a one-man project,
mm-hmm. that's
more than enough. I just checked the provider Mobix, Redux, you know, this new package Get.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, they are fantastic for, I think that if a lot of people are doing this, you know, when you have 5 Flutter developers, maybe they are useful. But for me, I want to keep core as, you know, small as possible, because you see, I use nothing special. So Stream Builder is the default widget. RxDart, it's a custom, third party package. But I think this is the very first package I add to my new project, because I used to use API. It's the same as in JavaScript, in .NET, in Java. So there are a lot of tutorials, animated tutorials. I really like it. And so I usually find this place, you know, that storage that can contain all of the data, add to it the stream and the API, with which I can change it. And for example, you see, it's a simple screen, but it's already required. In some cases, I just use set state. For example, if it's a small screen, you just need to save a local state, you know, for example, for text or something. I just use set state on Netlify. I think somewhere here I even use it. Yeah, you see when I press on the create new story. So let me press breakpoint here. So if I save it, save, return back.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you see, so it awaits on that screen. Yeah, once it does navigator.pop.
Mm-hmm.
I just manually updated the set state. So that's why after the save you could see it. Yeah, but with this approach to the with this stream builder, I can just remove it. So, but let me finish this execution.
Mm-hmm.
So this set state is no longer needed, but what I need to do anywhere where the story is added, for example, write, create a story.
Mm-hmm.
I should do this like changes.add. Like this. Someone writes a story, it will issue an update, delete, and there are different, for example, get catalog story, you don't need to notify consumers of your story persistence that something changed, because really nothing changed.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I really like this approach, and you know, it's even transferable between different frameworks and languages. Again, I started doing this in Objective-C. I had it in JavaScript. We had the backbone application with React, and it worked also good. And if the application is quite huge, I usually, you know, split it into different areas and create these small, you know, like Redux areas, so these like custom Redux areas. If it's more complicated and these Redux areas must talk between each other, of course, I think it's better to use some other package which does it. But that's a common problem, you know, when you have a huge application and clicking on a button can change like 20 objects in 20 different parts of the application. That's usually, and by the way, we can check by the way how it's exporting. So there is a possibility to export it. Clipboard. I have this, I use this. And you see that it's pretty even easy to modify it.
So very nice.
Step. Oh, for example, bold, And text is 1, 2, 4. And when I did the syntax corrections, I usually use Sublime Text. And, you know, check the grammar and syntax of my Ukraine, of my native language, embedded it. And actually, what you can do later, let's modify the title, your title too. I copy it, and you can back to store import. I think there was another bug there, but you see the
responsive design is always a problem.
Yeah, it works on my phone, but here this is Pixel 2, I think. Later, doesn't have enough space for import. Yeah, you see there is another. I think state issue that when we import a story, by the way, import, what happens when I press on import button? I think we just need to add it one more time, that changes.add. So, add container. I usually traverse the widget tree to the first unknown widget. So pet container, this is definitely not from the standard Flutter distribution. I press on it, it means that this is my container. Mm-hmm. And yes, this was my first try to animate something. So when you press on the button, oops, you didn't see it. One more time. Let me remove it. You see it goes to the right.
Yeah.
Slide to the right. So I call it slidable button. Mm-hmm. You can tell in what direction to write, to slide, right or left. Mm-hmm. And that was my, I think, the very, very first animation try. It works, at least does it add something to the application. And you see again, it pushes import. So review, let's see who, where is the state update? Yeah, write story.
Mm-hmm.
So you see, let me push it in a passport. So import, paste my responsive design. By the way, I did not have a chance to watch your responsive design. I saw that you almost finished the video, but it's 2 hours long.
So yeah, maybe. I think you have to skip the first hour because we had a lot of problems and issues. And
okay. Yeah, you see, like I said, I tried this in the morning and I already saw like $3.
Mm-hmm.
So what's happening here, I think it's write story. So again, we can do a wait, changes.add.
Mm-hmm.
And also, I think that I'm not using the correct call because this is custom story. You see, the story it used to save a runtime state and to save a. So let me come back. Creator story.
Mm-hmm.
And write creator story already has it. But again, Flutter is a live environment, but there are some limits to it. So let me import it again. So I noticed that if you place a breakpoint inside the method, modify this method and do library load, the changes are not there. So they will be on the next method call. So maybe this is an issue of the, because I'm always using master branch. Mm-hmm. Maybe in stable, there are no such problems, but.
I didn't debug so much, to be honest. It's really interesting how you work with what environment. To using debug parts way more than I do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because you see, if I copy this, for example, let's verify my assumption. So write story. Yeah, I will add this dummy and I will press a breakpoint.
Mm-hmm.
Let me return to them. So it will go inside write story. Let's actually step into.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, write creator story. Step out. And now let's see. So I did the library load. Let's see if it will go inside this. It popped. So we did not update the method because it was active. But on next call, it will do it. So
that's
also pretty fine. And what I really like and love about the Flutter is that you don't have to restart your application in 90% of cases. You can just
not reload the worst
button again. Yeah. For example, for Objective-C, it took about 5 minutes. I had my book error. It was pretty weak and 2 or 5 minutes. From the other side, you think about 10 times before hitting that build button. So you provide everything.
I was coming from Xamarin work and there wasn't nearly as excessive as there. So didn't make fun. Especially after long run, if you have larger applications, it was like, oh no.
Yeah. I actually had this when I use this third-party interactive engine packages, because I had to spend like 5 minutes run code. So let me just check my assumption.
Mm-hmm.
Paste. Import. Yeah, you see, it's updated using the string builder.
Nice.
And it's actually very good, because now this import lib store is you, so this import you doesn't have to know when to set state. So this widget doesn't know that after I return from that screen, do set state and so on.
Yeah,
string builder, it does everything and it's pretty good.
That looks very fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I saw also a second game that you that you wanted to present to us, and I think I took even a look into it. It looks like a city building game, right?
Yep, because I like to play this resource gathering city building game.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I think my very first game was Settlers, so it was from German company. Yeah, mm-hmm. I played Settlers 3, 4, 5. I did not like, so 3 and 4. I played with my sister for mm-hmm. like 5 hours of gameplay. It was pretty fantastic. But let me build it while it is building. So, but the games I find on App Store and Play Store, they, for example, you build a building and it says, okay, it will be finished in 3 hours. And I say, mm-hmm. I don't want to wait. You can buy some diamonds. They are always not enough. And
yeah.
I can understand that this gaming company, they have to earn money. Yeah. But mm-hmm. I'm doing this for myself, like I did this interactive fiction.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's still building. Yeah, Gradle is doing its job. And at the very beginning, I created it as a turn-based game because I didn't mm-hmm. know how to do this real-time resource gathering. So you just, issue a command, press make turn,
mm-hmm.
calculates everything, and gives you that you got plus 20 food, minus 5 warriors, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
And about 3 or 4 weeks ago, so I was satisfied with this iteration. I even added backend. So backend is written in Smalltalk. Maybe if we have time, I will show this. This is another mm-hmm. live environment. Pretty good. I even created a transpiler from Faro classes, from Smalltalk classes into the Dart classes. So you can mm-hmm. just issue a command and it will generate the full Dart code to be consumed. Yeah. If we have time. Let me switch to English. So this is my game. Mm-hmm. All of the graphic is done by me and my groupmate. So this is voxel graphic, pretty fun to do, by the way, on iPad, on Galaxy Note, if you have this stylus, pretty fun to do. They are 3D, but not in Flutter. Yeah, unfortunately, it doesn't mm-hmm. support this voxel. And for example, this is debug mode, yeah, and I have a choice. Big Sloboda means city, so in Ukrainian, a city of free people. So mm-hmm. I press it. It generates me a pretty huge easy stock. And there are some stats. So this is my inventory, 500 food. So we can press, this is gold.
Mm-hmm.
So this is money. This is food. You see, this is some bread. For example, what is this powder? So gunpowder. So we can create warriors. So mm-hmm. you can create horses and so on. And now I switch to the task based. So I call it, I don't know the correct name.
Mm-hmm.
And it was also pretty fun to do with Flutter. So again, everything is a widget. I'm using, I think, you see, this is like, how it's called, my new morphic design.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, another good package, let me advertise it, clay container. So
yeah.
At first I tried to do it on myself, but then I saw that someone already did it in Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
Why do I have to support it? You see, it's beautiful. I really like this shadow shape. Again, it's pretty simple. Everything is composable.
Mm-hmm.
It's visual. You can even, you see, do this effect to the text.
Yes.
So it's pretty good. I love it. So all of these containers are my containers. And by the way, another technique that I use when I develop UI,
mm-hmm.
for example, I know that I want some specific outlook of my application, some specific UI. For example, I knew that I want this like clickable button. Yeah, you see, this can mm-hmm. be clicked. Yeah. So, and I didn't know about the style. So I just mm-hmm. created a dummy container. I called it soft container.
Mm-hmm.
It was just soft container, accept child, and it what it does, it returns container with that child. So it was absolutely transparent proxy. So it's
mm-hmm.
an empty container. But later, like 1 or 2 months, I understood that I want to use this neuromorphic design.
Mm-hmm.
And I have this soft container. So what I did, so previously just returned, that like center,
mm-hmm.
child. So that's all. That's all it did. But later I just replaced it, so it's still child. But now it is wrapped inside clay container. And this is the
mm-hmm. effect.
and I just passed in. I did not have to find all of that, you know, containers, because container, I think, is after the padding widget, it's the most usable, the most used container in Flutter. So I just inserted inside this proxy, this Quake container, and all of my UI, and this, where I knew I would use this top container. So I name it, I don't know why. I think this design is also called called soft UI, soft design. Mm-hmm. It's another name of
exactly. But
it also runs on the web. Oops. I think I am in the middle of something here. So yeah, let me just do this. Boom.
Oh, careful! Not that you lose all your trackings.
Okay, then we don't go to that step. Okay.
Yeah, exactly. That's all right.
I think I added notification. So you see, you can go to the field.
Mm-hmm.
You can see what is going on here, how much it requires. So you can press on start, and here are the tasks. So
nice.
In 25 seconds, we will get 10 food. And what I added today is notification. So I have two tasks, and zero of them I get done.
Nice.
Yeah, and so we can wait on it to complete.
How did you create the game loop?
Yeah, so that was my main concern when I did it. So again, it was pretty interesting task to do.
Mm-hmm.
So game loop, yeah, you see it's collected. So what I have, so I have a separate widget, which renders this row. So it knows that task will produce 10 food in some amount of time, yeah? And it can provide collect button when everything is done. So what I do when this widget is initialized in init state, so this is stateful widget. In init state, I issue a periodic timer, you see, and I update the UI each second. If I see that the task, so this is my task, this is my abstraction, so it's that's another widget, taskable, yeah. So I call it taskable. I always try to, you know, avoid writing a lot of code. First I create data structure, which will work for me, and then I create, you know, an abstract code which can work with this data structure. So this is class taskable. You can provide how many workers it requires, how long it would take to complete the task, if it was started, at what time it will finish, what is required for input, and what will be the output of this task. So it's pretty simple. I also usually, so I serialize the state to the hard drive. So I usually create to JSON from JSON method. Previously, I used code generation tools, JSON serialize, JSON something else. But I don't know why it did not work well with my object-oriented class hierarchy that I created here, because sometimes it would say that this class is abstract, I cannot use it, and that mixing does not work, and so on. And also, that's additional step for the build, yeah? And I was fed with these build tools in JavaScript when we did this Backbone plus React application. So now I try to avoid these build steps as much as possible. If I can write manually, and actually some of the code is generated for me by the Smalltalk already. So I just, through JSON, it knows how to serialize itself to the map. And there is from JSON, it knows how to deserialize. Yeah,
right.
So.
Yeah, perfect.
And there are different methods. And let me return to this taskable.view. Yes, this one. So I issue a timer. Yeah, when this, for example, let me collect it. So in its state, well, let me just drop some. Let it be late. So I start a task. It tries to build it. Let's see what happens. So now the timer is fired. Yeah. So it starts, and the task is not yet done. Yeah. It just started. And what it does here is it sets state. It updates the state of this small widget. And here I just check that if it's done, then if it's not done, show the progress bar. If it's done, like this. Render the button collect items. Yeah.
Oh, that's nice. That's a good idea.
Yeah, but there is another issue that, let's see, for example, you see 30 seconds, I go mm-hmm. to this screen. It says zero completed, two in queue, yeah, in
yeah. active.
But now this view doesn't know when those tasks complete.
Mm-hmm.
Because this game loop, yeah, so this
mm-hmm. is internal.
Yeah, it's currently turned off. Yeah, because when I disclose, mm-hmm. I think I cancel. Yeah, you see. Mm-hmm. If I go back to the screen, it will refire. So now I need not to do the same as I did in this previous game. It's like a central place of mm-hmm. tasks. When some of the tasks have updated state, it's from, for example, in queue to in work, from in work to completed,
yep.
I should issue an event, and this whole screen, yeah, so this mm-hmm. my resource view, it should just update, or even not the whole screen, but this list items. So this list item, which is responsible for field, it knows, mm-hmm. yeah, that it has two tasks. And actually, if we go here, yeah, you see they're completed. Now the state is updated because I return back, you see, two from two. So that's my next task. And I think, you see, that's bad that I moved this core logic layer from my data structure, yeah, into mm-hmm. the UI level. So this is widget, it's UI level. And I cannot update the state
yeah.
Of the task because only when you go to the screen, the task state will be updated. So that's bad.
Yes.
But that was my first try, and I think I will move it to this class.
Mm-hmm.
It can even notify that I am done. Yeah, by the way, good idea.
But it's yeah. fantastic. So you still have a lot to do, obviously, but it looks already very good. So I'm pretty impressed, to be honest, because game development, I think, is still a big topic in Flutter, and it's still difficult, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
So it is great to see that there is also some progress, and I think it's really interesting to see and follow your progress. I think you have also a GitHub repository for that game, right? If I've seen that right?
Yes, everything is published. I even have a GitHub project here.
Mm-hmm.
So I track my progress. So it's called Sloboda, yeah, so
mm-hmm.
city. And by the way, there is a online version of this game. Well, let's check, because I always try to rebuild with latest Flutter, and sometimes mm-hmm. it's better to wait a couple of days. So yeah, you see, it still works.
But nice, everything there, all in the
yeah.
In the web. That's fantastic. So great. I will also add the links for that down in the video description below. We will see what you're making at progress. I'm really interested how your story app is working. I will download that right away. So thank you very much for joining me today, Dmytro. It was very nice
yeah.
to talk with you.
Yeah, thank you for inviting me. It was
very
a really
nice.
Pleasure. Yeah, showing this to you.
All right. I really hope you enjoyed this talk and this interview with Dmytro. He also has created all the projects in GitHub, so you will find the links down in the video description below. If you are new to this channel, this is the time where you hit the big subscribe button or give that video a like if you like that content. Thank you so much for joining. Until the next time, see ya guys.